Now, last week we met a couple of researchers that were big fans of a very colourful bird that's colonised cities and towns in southeast of England. It's the ring-necked parakeet. But, you know, not everyone is such a fan of this bird.
People have a love-hate relationship with ring-necked parakeets. What intrigues me is how they flourish. How do they do so well in environments that they're not made for? Probably one of the reasons why they're so successful is because people feed them. They'll eat all of your food. They dominate bird feeders. They come in large numbers.
Where you might expect to see a great tit or a blue tit, it's quite common to see, you know, a couple of parakeets fighting over a bird feeder around here.
We don't know whether or not ring-necked parakeets are having any kind of impact on our native flora or fauna. Very little research has been done on this. There is a potential for impact.
My concern about them would be whether or not they displace the wildlife like woodpeckers in the woodlands here.
Ring-necked parakeets are secondary cavity nesters, meaning they don't make their own holes. They nest in holes or cavities that are already there. They really like old woodpecker holes, and they reuse them. They'll nest in them more than 1 year. Not necessarily the same family, but they will reuse them.
It's not just the trees that the parakeets nest in. They will find any hole to nest in, so any sort of loft space, any brick that's basically loose, they will get in there and make their home there.
You either love them or you hate them.
Oh, here we are, Chris Packham versus the touchscreen. Right, where are the parakeets? They're not in the North Sea, as it's trying to indicate itself here. Where these birds are at the moment is very much around Greater London here, and there are a few more down on the Thames estuary in East Kent. And over the years, they've started to spread out. There were a few up in Birmingham and a few in Liverpool as well. Now, debate rages a little bit when they first arrived here, certainly by the late 60s, and they were first breeding down here in Kent in 1971. The interesting thing is that although the population is increasing by about 30% every year, its distribution isn't expanding. So the density of birds is increasing, particularly in the Greater London area here, but they're not spreading out very much. Occasionally you get sightings across the rest of the UK, even some up in Scotland, but it's an increase in density, not dispersion, that we see. Now, we also ask you to help out with Hazel Jackson's feathers. Well, I'm not at Hazel Jackson's feathers, because she obviously doesn't have feathers, Hazel Jackson. I mean, she might just peel off her coat and she's got some lovely green scapulars behind her. Maybe she's got some wonderful primaries, I don't know. That wasn't a euphemism either. It's lucky I didn't mention her undertail coverts, wasn't it? Which I just did. Anyway, basically what we want you to do is to collect the feathers, if you are living in the Greater London or Kent area, any ring-necked parakeet feathers that you find, put them in an envelope and send them to Hazel Jackson. I'm Alan Partridge, I think. Aha!
You've lost it, Victor. This parakeet has actually colonised your jacket.
It has. Where's it gone? Where's Ricky?
It's
he was just Rudy. Having a little... It's Rudy. Rudy was having a little kissing session before.
Where's he gone?
Hello, love. And we ought to point out that Rudy, when he goes out socially, he does always wear that little red coat there. But he's about 10 weeks old. We say he. We don't know if he's a girl or a boy. But he looks very, very beautiful. Hasn't yet developed that ring around his neck.
He seems to be enjoying himself.
Hello. yes, don't bite me too hard if you do. Anyway,
let's talk about the origins, though, of where they come from. Yeah. Because you were saying earlier that when you go to India, you can always hear
It's the sound of Delhi. You hear these ringnet parakeets screeching and screeching, and it's bizarre to go to London, somewhere like Richmond Park, and you think, what's that sound? It sounds so familiar.
It's the British Empire, isn't it? It really is.
But people are surprised that they can survive here because they think that they're from warm countries.
Yeah.
But they're actually from the foothills of the Himalayas, so they're used to the cold. What they're not used to is frost, though. And they actually suffer from frostbite on their toes. Martin?
Yeah, sorry, I'm getting carried away.
I mean, it was me and Monty. Me and Monty getting it on.
Yeah, now we're in love, I think.
But we want to know, is it urban myth about how they actually came to this country?
That's fascinating, isn't it? Did they escape from a film set, The African Queen, in 1951?
Well,
that's what they say.
Yeah, but they weren't actually noted here until the late 60s, and they didn't breed till 71. So what were they doing between 51 and 71? That doesn't sound right, does it?
You just nailed that one, mate.
They were just hiding in the underground or something? Clearly not.
What about the second one, which is that Jimi Hendrix came over here and he released them, he went to Carnaby Street, he let them go to put a bit of colour into the sky, man.
What, to improve the purple haze, the smog
right.
over London,
that's
yeah.
Right. Lovely idea.
Is it urban myth? I think, actually, that it's just like our parakeet here, there were a lot of pets that accidentally got released.
Let's ask the audience.
And
look,
they colonised.
If you know, perhaps your grandmother, your grandfather had an aviary somewhere around London in the late 60s, early 70s. Maybe they were releasing these things. Maybe they had a big row over the Sunday lunch. Someone went out and let the parrots loose. Let us know. We'd love to know.
Now, over the last few weeks, we've had dramatic scenes of life and death, but that's what spring is about. It's about mating, it's about birds, it's about building nests, it's about survival. It's basically a time of renewal. Beautiful.
It's gorgeous.
Beautiful. What are you looking at me like that for?
I'm still thinking about the Undertale coverts, actually. I'm apologising to Hazel Jackson later, but anyway, go on.
Let's have a look at some of our live cameras. Let's take a look at our bitten cam. Oh, look.
Gone to sleep.
You never know, we might hear a bitten snoring.
Is the adult there, though, or is that our couple, just the youngsters? That looks like just the youngsters. I don't think the adult's there at the moment, actually. She's not there, is she? But they're still coming back to the nest. They're still coming back. Yeah. OK, well, coming up tomorrow, what have we got? Let's have a look. We've got Itchy and Scratchy. It's the white-tailed eagles from Mull. Yolo Williams will be up there looking at the namesakes of my poodles.
And we're going to catch up with our incredibly adventurous bitten chicks. Look at that. They're actually grasping the reeds now, just like Mum.
There's exciting news of a new arrival to the UK, the continental swallowtail butterfly.
What a beauty.
Of course, Unsprung will be coming straight after us on the red button and online with Nick Baker, so make sure you tune into that by pressing that red button. But as for us, we will see you tomorrow at 8 o'clock. Lots of live cameras we'll be looking at. So we'll see you then. BBC Two from us. Bye-bye for now.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.